There are many different ways to collect data, and what we're going to do is talk through the different sampling methods that can be used. When we're told how data was collected, it's important to note which sampling method was used, because with each one, there are benefits and kind of downfalls to each of these, and we want to be careful of those possible downfalls, in which it would make us not really trust the data that we got out. So what we're going to do is talk through the method, describe the method that's being used, and then we're going to apply an example to it, which is going to link to if we wanted to survey PCC students on how much they pay for housing per month, how would we collect that data? So, starting off with a census, this is where we sample the entire population. So, if we were collecting this data about housing per month for PCC students, this is where we would survey every PCC student. So this is getting at the idea of population data. To get population data, we'd have to run a census, which most of the time is very difficult to obtain. It often takes a lot of time, which means it could be taking a lot of money as well. It's very difficult to accomplish, but again, if we got this data out, it would be very, very accurate. So that's a census. Our next method is a simple random sample, and this method right here is the one we want to use whenever we can. You might see this shortened in some places as SRS, just stands for simple random sample. And this is where individuals are chosen at random, which means that each individual in the population has an equal chance of being selected for this survey. Typically, making this random selection, we'd want to use technology of some sort to make that random selection. Typically, humans are not great at being random, so we need to rely on technology there. So what we would do is choose a sample size. So let's say we were selecting 100 students, and what we could do is use technology to randomly select 100 PCC students to survey. So simple random sample, it's great. It's not very difficult to obtain. It kind of depends on your sample size. The only thing you really want to be careful of is to make sure your sample size is large enough, which our general rule of thumb that we'll follow is over 30. Typically, a sample size larger than 30 is going to give us good results. If you go beyond that, that's even better. Like a sample size of 100, will give us great results. Stratified sampling. So with stratified sampling, I'm going to draw a little picture for us on this right-hand side here, starting with a big block. The big block is going to represent our population. First thing we do with stratified sampling is break the population into subgroups. So we would choose some sort of grouping to separate our population. We'd want to divide up our population. Everyone should be able to fit into different groups. So maybe what we could do for our example is separate students by zip code. Then what we do is we take a random sample from each of these groupings. So what this does is where we have these groupings is we're going to talk to people in every single one of the groups, which is very good, from each group. So we talk to a few people in this first group and that next one, and we cover all of the groups. So for our example, if we separate by zip code, then what we could do is randomly survey 10 students from each zip code. So this works great in this case, especially if we're interested in paying for housing, because typically different zip codes put you into different areas of Portland or wherever the students are living. If we separate by zip code, this kind of guarantees an even spread across the whole city. We wouldn't be leaving out whole zip codes. We talk to everyone across the groups. So with that, this is a great case. Only thing we have to be careful of is that our grouping should make sense. Like, zip code's great, it's beneficial to the idea of payment for housing. If we separated by another factor, say we were using first letter of the last name, wouldn't make as much sense here. It wouldn't be beneficial to make sure that we talk to people with S's for their last name versus T's for their last names. It wouldn't necessarily matter. So zip code's beneficial here. So layers should make sense, or the grouping should make sense. For cluster sampling, it's gonna sound very similar to stratified. We're gonna do the same thing where we start with our population and we're gonna break it into subgroups. So we start by breaking population into subgroups. Then what we do is we randomly select some of the groups. So with this, what we would do is we'd have, again, technology or computer say, okay, choose some of these groups. Let's say the computer told us to talk to these four groups for our small example here. Then what we would do is, once we know what groups to talk to, we talk to everyone in those groups. So we randomly select some groups, and then we survey everyone in those groups. So what we end up doing is covering the entire group, as compared to stratified, where they just talk to some of the people in each group. Here we choose some groups and talk to everyone in some of those groups. So say we kept with our separation by zip code. So if we separate by zip code, and then what we could do is and randomly select ten zip codes to survey all students in. So we'd randomly select 10 zip codes, and then any student that's in that zip code is getting a survey. Now with this, using zip code isn't great, because what happens with cluster is entire groups are left out in terms of zip code. That's not good here, because as we were saying with stratified, having this widespread of zip codes, which often have these types of neighborhoods associated with them, we want this even spread across those neighborhoods. Whereas here, to leave out entire neighborhoods, we might be focused on, say, lower types of housing, or maybe fancier types of housing, which is gonna skew our data. So typically with cluster, you actually want your layers to not make sense. Like here, a good method would be using that first letter of the last name. Only talk to the B's, D's, S's, and T's, or something like that. That won't have a strong effect on the data. It's not related. It'll give you a good sample size, but the data wouldn't be affected by if we focused on zip code. Systematic sampling is where we survey every nth individual. Meaning we choose a number and we use that number to separate our population. So let's say in a list of all PCC students, I choose every 20th student from a list of all PCC students. So you just choose a number to use. You just want to make sure you'll get a large enough sample size there. So like I wouldn't want to choose every 1,000th student. And so make sure you end up with a large enough sample size doing this. And another difficulty of it is we need a countable population. Like in this case, we have a countable population because I can make a list of all PCC students. That's possible. If we were doing something like sampling apples out of a batch or something, then it's more difficult to count because they all look very similar. It can be hard to choose, like choosing every fifth apple out of a basket of apples, not so easy to do. So sometimes systematic isn't even possible. We need to make sure it's a countable population. Multistage is just where we use multiple sampling methods. So for example, what we could do is mix together cluster sampling and then run a simple random sample. So what that would look like is first I start with all PCC students, and then maybe I randomly select 10 zip codes. So what might would happen is if we start with all PCC students, now my data's smaller because now I only have the list of PCC students from these 10 zip codes. But then what I can do is with this list of students from the 10 zip codes is randomly select 100 students from that list. So the cluster would kind of give me a separation of the groups, and then a simple random sample would help me make kind of a smaller sample size, but with that first separation. So multistage just combines different methods. Now these next two sampling methods are very commonly used, and what we want to be careful of is that they generally have bias attached to them as well. So the first one we're going to talk about is this voluntary or self-selected sampling. This is where individuals volunteer to be part of the survey. So what this might look like in terms of our example is we send an email survey to all PCC students. And we use the responses we get back. So what's happening here is it kind of starts as an attempt at a census. But if I send out an email to every single PCC student, I'm not going to expect to get every single response back. If I'm not getting every single response back, it's no longer a census. The responses I'm getting back, they're volunteering, they're taking their own time to fill out the survey and return it to me. So that's what makes it voluntary sampling instead of a census, is that I'm only using the responses I get back. Really, this happens with kind of any optional survey that's sent out. If you take the time to fill it out, you're volunteering your information. Also, any sort of internet poll, if you visit a website where they want you to answer a question real quick, you're volunteering your information, taking your time to answer it, where you answer it, your friend could choose to completely ignore it. Also, online reviews are a great example of voluntary sampling. If you buy something from Amazon or go to Yelp, those reviews that are being listed, people are volunteering their time and offering that information and providing that data. And this is where we can start to see where the bias can come through. with online reviews, it's typically people that are either very happy with their experience or very dissatisfied with their experience. You rarely get the middle ground. Sometimes people are good reviewers and they offer that middle ground, but typically it's either very good things or very bad things. In terms of taking the time to answer like optional surveys or internet polls, you usually take the time when you're interested in the topic. If I get an email about a survey about math education, I'm probably going to answer it because I have insight into it. I'm interested in it as well. So with that, with voluntary sampling, there's something called voluntary bias. That the data you get out when you send these optional surveys, it's going to bias the data because there's usually a strong opinion attached to it. And if there's a strong opinion, that's skewing the data. So with the voluntary, and as you can tell, like optional surveys, internet polls, and online reviews, you've probably come across at least one of those in your life. And that just shows how commonly they're used. It's the easiest way to collect data. However, there's going to be bias in it. So if we make any calculations or summaries from it, we have to be aware of this bias that comes through by using only volunteers. Another method is convenience sampling, and this is where the sample is made up of the first individuals or things that you come across. So convenience sampling definitely links to the word convenient. It's something that's easy, it's easily found, it's easy to collect the data. So say I was collecting this information on PCC, what would be convenient is if I just survey my Math 243 students. I could get a decent sample size, I have large groups, I would get enough information, but as soon as I only survey those closest to me, there's something linking you. All of you are in Math 243. All of you are interested in taking classes online primarily. So with that, having those linking pieces leads to lurking variables, and that starts affecting our data and causes convenience bias. So convenience bias comes through because there's lack of randomness in our sampling. If there's a lack of randomness, there are usually lurking variables. So voluntary bias and convenience bias, the most common voluntary sampling and convenience sampling are used so often because they're easy. But what we need to keep in mind is for a good sample, sampling should not be easy. The easier it gets, the more lurking variables are probably sneaking in there. So we want to avoid voluntary and convenient sampling. However, voluntary bias is often going to be there because as human beings, things have to be voluntary. We can't really force people to answer surveys. However, you can offer incentives, but then that might be introducing bias. So we just want to be careful of any bias that could misrepresent our data.